Hello everyone. So welcome to the part one of NCERT as it is review on polymers. Now there will be a second part video also. So those who are watching this video, right, you can take a look at the second part also, so that you will be able to complete the chapter thoroughly. Now, like we used to mention at the end beginning of every NCERT as it is, the thing that we need to keep in mind is we are going to go almost as per the NCERT textbook. Only couple of places we might want to discuss some additional aspects, because you know, as such, right, we have a separate video lecture series on the polymers where we'll have a detailed coverage. But the NCERT as it is, right, particularly for the students who are focusing on JEE mains or NEET, this is to cover the NCERT thoroughly. So what are these polymers basically? I mean, when you look at things around us, right, even you know, the marker that I am using to write on the touchpad, right, so what is this? This is also made up of polymer. So the things that we see around us, most of our day-to-day life, right, is dependent upon the polymers. You talk about the plastic buckets, you talk about cups, saucer, the toys that kids used to play, packaging bags, synthetic clothing material. Nowadays, you know, because of this COVID and all that, we see people using PPE kits. They are made up of what? Synthetic clothing material. Automobile tires, electrical insulating materials, all these are what? They are different types of polymers. Now, when you look at the importance of polymers in chemical industry, right, you'll see that we have a plastics industry, we have elastomers, rubber industry, fibers, all our nylon, rayon. Then we have paints and varnishes. So all these are basically a part of the polymer industry. And you know, when you look at the use of polymers, right, it is based on what is the specific characteristics they will have. Like, you know, when you use a particular polymer as an electrical insulating material, it must be having what? High electrical resistance. Same way, if you are using a substance for making the high tension ropes, bungee jumping and all that, right, you see people tied to a rope. Obviously the rope cannot get cut, so which means what? It should have a high tensile strength. So the specific characteristics of these polymer materials, right, they'll be useful in finding the relevant applications. As we go into the discussion, right, we'll talk about, we'll not cover the entire polymers as such, but whatever is there in the NCERT purview, right, we'll try to look at those polymers, their characteristics, and where they will find the uses. But if you talk about polymers, I mean, it's sounding as if, you know, we are talking about everything that is synthesized by us in laboratory or in industry. It's not like that. Even, you know, nature, right, itself is like a very advanced polymer industry. So after some time, we will talk about this concept called as copolymerization. So polymer means, you know, we will be having what we will refer to as the repeating units. A polymer is made up of what? Repeating units. We will be calling the repeating units as monomers. So copolymerization means you have different types of monomers. And this copolymerization will be able to bring really, really specific characteristics. That is the advantage of the copolymerization. We'll see some examples of the copolymerization also, and what are the very prominent copolymers, we'll talk about it. But the naturally available polymers, right, like, you know, polypeptides, they are actually copolymer of 20 different types of amino acids. About these, you know, the natural polymers, right, whether it is polypeptides or the cellulose, starch, all these things we have studied in the biomolecules also. Okay, so which means the idea of copolymerization and the applications, while in laboratories and industries people are still trying to get detailed study about it, nature is kind of, you know, in a very advanced stage. So we have the polypeptides, which are a copolymer of different 20 different types of amino acids. So the idea is that the concept of polymerization, right, is not just something that is related to the industry, it is also related to the biological systems. Okay, so we'll learn as we go further more about it. But just to get the idea of what is a polymer, right, I mean, from the word Greek origin, A poly means many, mer means unit. So we are basically having many repeating units, and that is the reason why the polymer entities, right, will be large molecules. So the molecular mass will be in the range of 10 power 3 to 10 power 7 unified mass unit. So generally, if you look at the monomers, right, they will have a molecular mass which is in the normal range. Like, you know, we have ethene. Ethene is a monomer for polyethene. Ethene is what? CH2 double bond CH2. The molecular mass of ethene is 28 U. But if you look at the molecular mass of the polyethene, right, it will be in a very significantly higher order, because we have the number of repeating units to be very large. All that we will see as we go into further discussion. But if you look at the polymer as such, right, we can see the polymer entity as a macromolecule. So how this macromolecule is coming? Because of the joining of these repeating units. These repeating units, we call them as what? Monomers. And the thing is, when you look at the joining of these monomers to form a polymer, right, it is not like they have some kind of a van der Waals interaction or anything. This is actually what the bonding between the monomer units is, actually a proper covalent bonding. This is not a weak interaction like a van der Waals force or anything. This is a proper covalent bonding. So the monomers are linked to each other by covalent bonds. And the process by which we will convert the monomers into polymer, right, that is what we will be calling as the polymerization. In fact, after some time, we will see there are different ways of achieving the polymerization. Okay, so we will talk about that also. But generally here, right, it is important to note down one thing, because polymers, we are saying that they are macromolecules, but not every macromolecule is a polymer. So macromolecules, we can have polymers, or we can also have general macromolecules, which will not have the repeating units. They are large molecules, but they will not have any repeating unit. Best example for that is hemoglobin. Hemoglobin is also a macromolecule, but it is not a polymer. Okay. So this is about the understanding of what are polymers. Now we'll see, I mean, we'll see how we can obtain the polyethene from ethene, and also how we can obtain nylon 6,6. We'll see the reason why this name also comes. Nylon 6,6, right, is obtained from hexamethylene diamine and then adipic acid. So we'll see how these polymers actually will be obtained. Ethene, we know it will have a unsaturation. There is a pi bond. So if you take one ethene and then remove the pi bond, both these carbons now are having what? One valency deficit. So if we can arrange various other ethene in a line where, you know, we will try to meet the valency or the valency deficit by forming a bond, covalent bond between adjacent ethene units. Look at this. We'll form a bond here. We'll form a bond. Once we form the bond, right, what is happening? The valency deficit is completed. Like this, we'll have a chain that is going to have various ethene units repeating itself. So this kind of a polymerization, right, we'll be calling it as addition polymerization. For the addition polymerization, we must have unsaturation. Unsaturation means it can be double bond, it can be triple bond, it can be diens also. Diens means they'll have two double bonds. So how do we represent the polymer structure? We'll have the repeating unit put within the bracket, parenthesis, and then we will indicate n. So here nobody will ask us what is the value of this n, because the n number can be changing. So this will tell us the structure of the polyethene. So inside parenthesis, right, what we will mention is the repeating unit of the polymer. Now one possible question is, if they are giving us the polymer structure, right, then they can ask us what is the corresponding monomer. They'll give us a polymer structure like that, and they can ask us what is the corresponding monomer. So we'll talk about it a little later, but that is a possible question. So giving the structure of polymer and asking us the monomer. That is one possible question. If these are the examples that we are already seeing in the NCERT, some students, they will even remember these examples as such. But otherwise, there is also one method to answer those questions. When there is a polymer structure given, straight away we can tell what is the corresponding monomer for that. Okay, so we'll see what is the technique also later. Then the other example is hexamethylene diamine or adipic acid. You see here, hexamethylene diamine, right, has got 6 carbons. NH2, CH2 6 times. Adipic acid is a dibasic acid. HCOO, CH2 4 times, COH. It has also got 6 carbons. That is why the name nylon 6,6. After some time, we will see there are other types of nylons also. Okay, so we'll have nylon 6. So we'll see why those names are coming. Here, because the monomers, right, each of them is having what, 6 carbons. That's why nylon 6,6. There is a difference. The previous example, right, that we discussed, what is it? The polythene formation. It is an example of addition polymerization. Here, this one, right, is going to be called as a condensation polymerization. So, what is a condensation polymerization? Basically, we'll have here there is no addition that will happen because there is no unsaturation. From the hexamethylene diamine, the nitrogen is bonded to 2 hydrogens. One hydrogen will be removed. And from the carboxylic acid group, OH will be removed. So totally, what is the entity that is removed? Water is removed. So which means here we have NH that is now having what? Valency deficit, because hydrogen is removed, right? And this side we have a carbon that is valency deficit. The nitrogen and carbon, they will form a bond. Other things will be as it is. CH2 4 times. This side CO also. Here what is it? CH2 6 times. So this will be repeating. So this is what is the repeating unit of the nylon 6,6. So here the condensation polymerization, right, will happen because of the removal of small molecules or entities like water. Sometimes it will be HCl, like that, you know. Sometimes we may even remove alcohol. So the removal of these small molecules, right, will be the phenomena that happens in the condensation polymerization. Okay, so we'll see some more examples, because this is just an idea of how do we obtain the polymers. In fact, we will study in detail about the addition polymerization, and also we'll study in detail about the condensation polymerization. Okay, now when you look at the polymers, right, so this is one important area in terms of questions. The classification of the polymers. We can classify the polymers based on different criteria. So first criteria we are seeing is what? The classification based on the source where we obtain these polymers from. So here one thing that is important is examples. So we have to keep making a note of examples. Natural polymers are basically the ones that will obtain naturally. Like, you know, we have proteins, cellulose, starch, all these things we have studied in the biomolecules. Resins, organic resins. Rubber is obtained from the latex that is coming from the rubber tree. So all these are what? The examples of the natural polymers. They are obtained naturally. And if we make some modification to these natural polymers, right, like, you know, we get cellulose, we modify it to get rayon. Rayon is what? Cellulose acetate. We take cellulose and process it with nitric acid in the presence of some other acid like HCl or sulfuric acid. We'll get what? Cellulose nitrate. Okay, so here the structure and other things are not important, but just the idea of what is cellulose nitrate, it's a very explosive substance. We also call it as gun cotton. Okay, so this is used as an explosive material. So what is the semi-synthetic? We'll take the naturally occurring and then we'll modify it or process it. Then we have pure synthetic. They are not obtained naturally, we have to process them in laboratory or in the industry. So we have plastics, synthetic fibers like nylon 6, all these are our synthetic fibers. We'll see some more examples. Okay, then we have synthetic rubbers, Buna-S, then we have Buna-N. Okay, all these are what? Examples of the synthetic rubbers. So all of them, they are processed or they are synthesized in the laboratory or in the industry. That's why we call them as what? Synthetic polymers. So here again, I'm repeating, the examples of different class of the polymers, right? That is a very prominent question. If you look at past years in both JEE as well as NEET, right, you will see that these kind of questions will be very prominent. Then we can also classify the polymers based on the structure. We can have a linear polymer. Just know we have the polymer which is a linear chain. The best example for this is high density polythene. So previously we talked about the polythene, right? So if we have a polythene which is just a straight chain, long linear chain, right, we call it as what? A high density polythene. We can in short call it as HDP. In some textbooks, right, they will also refer to this as HDPE, high density polyethylene. Both are same thing. Okay, so because and also PVC, polyvinyl chloride, that is also what? Linear polymer. Okay, so PVC is basically, we'll have vinyl chloride is what? CH2 double bond CHCl. This is the vinyl chloride. Polymer of this, right, will be what? Polyvinyl chloride. It's an addition polymer. Just like polythene, this is also what? Addition polymer. So they will have a long straight chain so that the polymer will be more efficiently packed. So here the packing, right, will be very efficient. And that is the reason why we will get what? High density polythene. Whereas we have the low density polythene, we call it as LDP. As I said, it can be also called as what? LDPE, low density polyethylene. So we have the linear chain to which there will be some branches. Okay, how the branches will be obtained, we will discuss about it. Okay, but because of the branches, right, the polymer units will not be packed efficiently. As a result, right, the density of this will be what? Less. So that is the basic difference between HDP and then LDP. So HDP, only long chain, more efficient packing, so hence the density will be high. LDP, branches will be there, so inefficient packing, so density will be what? Less. Then we have one more type which is called as the cross-linked or the network polymers. So what is this cross-linked or the network polymers? If you have a polymer that is formed between a bifunctional and trifunctional monomer, what is this functional group, so to say? When you have a monomer, right, already we talked about the examples of ethene. So you see ethene, once you remove this pi bond, right, there are two valency deficit sites. Both of them can be used for the formation of the polymer. They will be participating in the bonding so that the polymer will be obtained. So this will be calling as what? Bifunctional. Basically the active sites. Similarly, we can have molecules or entities where there will be three active sites. We call them as what? Trifunctional. So look at this. When you have monomer unit which is having trifunctional, then what happens is that additional functional site, right, that can be used for forming the cross-linking. So the long chains, they'll be cross-linked with the proper covalent bonds. The cross-linking is not like a Van der Waals interaction or anything. It's what? A strong covalent bond that will be there between the long polymer chains. And because of this, right, there will be some specific properties that these cross-linked or network polymers will have. And so we'll see the examples, you know, Bakelite and Malamine, right? We'll see the actual structures of Bakelite and Malamine also as we go. Here, let us not discuss about them. Just the idea of what is a typical structure of a cross-linked or network polymer. So this is what we'll have. So understand the difference between the branched and then cross-linked. Branched means what? The branches will be hanging. Cross-linked is what? It is a bonding between two different, you can see, from one long chain to another long chain, there is a proper covalent bond. So this is what is the cross-linked or the network polymer. Examples are what? Bakelite and then Malamine. So once we go through the actual structures of the Bakelite and Malamine, right, we will be able to understand this. Okay, so this is how we can classify the polymers based on the structure. Then we can also classify the polymers based on the mode of polymerization. Already we given some brief idea about it. What is it? We can have addition polymers. So we have a monomer which is having unsaturation, means what? Double bond or triple bond, or even diens, unsaturation. They can be added to form the polymer. So polythene is obtained from what? Ethene. Polypropene, is obtained from what? Propene. All these are our examples of what? The adhesion polymers. Already we have seen how the polyethylene is obtained. If you have the adhesion polymer formed with only one monomer, right, we call it as what? Homopolymer. Best example is this one, polyethylene. Even polypropene also, only one monomer is there. That's why we call it as what? Homopolymer. In polyethylene, already we said, right, there will be two different types that we will obtain, HDP and then LDP. We will discuss about it later. That will come. If you have a polymer, adhesion polymer, which is obtained from two different monomers, we call it as what? Copolymer. Examples are Buna S and Buna N. These are what? Synthetic rubbers. Buna S and Buna N are what? Synthetic rubbers. So we will see what is Buna S here. Okay. So we have 1,3-butadiene. And styrene. What is styrene? C6H5 CH, a double bond CH. This is styrene. You see here there are two pi bonds. In this there is one pi bond. Let us just remove the pi bond. So once we remove the pi bond, then what will happen? There will be valency deficit that will come. So look at this. So we'll take one unit of this 1,3-butadiene. CH2, CH, CH, CH2. There is a valency deficit. Then we have, of course, styrene. Here also, once we remove the pi bond, right, there will be valency deficit. Now, what happens is the terminal carbon of the 1,3-butadiene and the carbon of the styrene, right, they both can form a covalent bond so that they will be able to meet their valency requirement. If that happens, right, then this side also there will be the continuation of the chain. This side also there will be continuation of the chain. As a result, what happens is this carbon also will meet the valency. These two already they have met the valency. There is a chain, right, that also will be able to meet the valency. The only problem will be with these two carbons, you see here, this and this, because they are not able to meet the valency requirement. What they can do, they can form an additional bond between them. Thereby, they are able to meet the valency requirement. That is it. So we are able to obtain the copolymer of 1,3-butadiene and then styrene. So what is it going to be called as? The butadiene styrene copolymer. In short, what do we call it as? Buna S. Okay, Buna N we will see later. So you see here, what is it? CH2, CH double bond, CH, CH2. This part is coming from the styrene. CH2, CH, C6H5. So sometimes, you know, we can even expect straight questions. There will be straight questions asking us what is the correct representation of the Buna S. Like that, they will ask straight questions. In Buna S, remember, there will be one unsaturation. That point we should keep in mind. Okay. So this is about the copolymers. I mentioned, right, these kind of questions will be common. Like they will give us the polymer structure like this. So when they put within the bracket means what? That is the repeating unit part. They are asking what is the monomer for this. So how do we answer such questions? It's a very simple thing. Whenever they give us the polymer structure and asking what is the monomer, right, all we need to be doing is just remove these parentheses. Just remove them and write down the unit here. CH3, CH3, CH2. But you know this carbon is one valency deficit. This is also one valency deficit. How they can meet the valency requirement? By forming an additional bond. That's it. So all we need to do is what? Whenever they are giving us a, this is for the homopolymers. When they give us the repeating unit structure for the homopolymer, right? For the homopolymers, when they give us the repeating unit structure, all we need to do is what? Just remove the bracket. Take out that entity separately. We will see that there will be some positions where there is a valency deficit. To meet the valency deficit, form the extra bonds. That's it. So this is actually what? The monomer. Sometimes they can even, instead of giving the structure of the monomer, right, they can give us the names. Like option A, option B, they will give us the names of these monomers, IUPAC nomenclature basis. Okay. So this part we have to be clear. See, always, right, when we are reading the NCERT from the examination point of view, yes, one part is knowledge. The second part will be, we have to always keep an eye on what kind of questions are asked. Then the other type of polymerization is condensation polymerization. Already we talked about it. The condensation polymers, right? They are formed by the repeated condensation between what? Two different bifunctional or trifunctional monomeric unit. The example that we saw, right? What is it? Nylon 6,6. It is formed by the condensation between two different units. You see, what is it? Hexamethylene diamine and then adipic acid. So both are having six carbons. That's why the name is what? Nylon 6,6. Already we have seen how the condensation polymerization happens. Here, what is it? There is a loss of the water molecule. Again, I am saying the structure of nylon 6,6. This is also a very prominent question. Okay. And I mean, in this case, what is the molecule that is lost? It is the water, removal of water. We can also have removal of alcohol. We can also have removal of HCl. Okay, so that can be happening in the case of formation of other condensation polymers. Look at this question. It's an example question. They are giving us a polymer structure. They are asking whether it is a homopolymer or copolymer. Look at it. Now, what is this? This is actually polystyrene. So, if you want to obtain the monomer, right, just remove that parenthesis. Just remove it. Remaining is what? CH2. CH C6H5. These two carbons are one valency deficit, right? How we can meet it? Form an extra bond. What is this? This is the styrene. So the polymer that is given to us is what? Polystyrene, which is a homopolymer. And what is the monomer for that? Monomer is what? Styrene is the monomer. Okay. Next, we can have the classification of the polymers based on the, we can say, nature of the intermolecular forces or the strength of the intermolecular forces. So based on the intermolecular forces, we can classify the polymers. When you talk about the intermolecular forces, right, obviously the mechanical properties like tensile strength, elasticity, toughness, all these are related to what? Intermolecular forces. The intermolecular forces generally that we will be referring to is what? One, the van der Waals forces. Second, the stronger one is what? The hydrogen bonding. So only in some cases we'll have the hydrogen bonding. So wherever there is hydrogen bonding, right, that will give rise to what? A high tensile strength and high value for the modulus of elasticity wherever these intermolecular forces are strong. That will make these kind of polymers to be suited in the specific applications. Okay, so for example, when you want to use the a polymer for making of the ropes, tight ropes, etc., right, the cable ropes and all that, we'll require a high tensile strength. So in that case, what we'll use? We'll use a polymer that is having typically this hydrogen bonding. Okay, so we'll talk about that. So we have the elastomers. Elastomers means the thing that we need to keep in mind is rubber. Okay, these elastomers, right, they'll have the weakest intermolecular forces, van der Waals forces. Okay, so they allow the weakest intermolecular forces, means what? They can be stretched. So by applying a small force itself, they can be stretched. Think of rubbers. Rubbers are what? Elastomers. But if you can achieve a cross-linking, like you have the polymer chains, we can have a cross-linking. We'll study about it. The cross-linking of the natural rubber, right, will be done by using a method called as what? Vulcanization. So with the help of the methods like vulcanization, when you are able to build the cross linking, right, it will help the polymer to regain this original shape. Once we remove the deforming forces, right, we apply a force to deform it. We remove it means it can regain the original shape if we are able to have these cross links introduced. And that is the specific purpose why we will be doing the vulcanization of the rubber. Okay, so in vulcanization of the rubber, we will have what? A sulfur cross links. We will study about it. Okay. The other examples of these elastomers are what? The synthetic rubbers, BuNOS, BuNON, neoprene. So neoprene is what? This is the structure of neoprene. Okay. So look at this. What is it? CH2, CCl, double bond CH, CH2. This is the repeating unit. Okay. So we'll talk about the neoprene also once we go and discuss about the rubbers. So all these, whenever we have a polymer name, right, the thing that we need to keep in mind is what is the polymer structure, and what are the, if there is only one monomer, what is the monomer, if there are like two monomers, because we usually in our coverage rate we have only up to two monomer units. If there are two monomers, means we should know what are the two monomers, that's it. Okay, so this is about the elastomers. Then we have on the other side very strong intermolecular forces, hydrogen bonding. We will take a look at the nylon 6,6. So because of the hydrogen bonding, right, see here the hydrogen is bonded to what? Electronegative element. That can give rise to what? The hydrogen bonding between different chains. When there is this hydrogen bonding, right, that will make sure that these polymers, they are having high tensile strength and also high modulus of elasticity. And that is the reason why these fibers, right, they are the ones that are used for making of these ropes, cables, etc. Okay, so they'll have strong intermolecular forces that will even lead to close packing of the chains. When there is a close packing of the chains, means what? We'll have a crystalline structure. Examples for this is polyamides. So nylon 6,6, if you look at the structure, right, what is it? NHCO, what is this? Amide. So this nylon group, right, we'll call them as what? Polyamides. Similarly, we also have polyesters. Pyrrolidine, we will see that. Okay, so that is also an example of what? Fibers. They'll have what? Strong intermolecular forces like hydrogen bonding. Then we have intermediate between the elastomers and then fibers. In between, we have thermoplastic polymers. They'll be what? They'll have a linear chain, or they can sometimes have a slight branching also is there. Okay. The thing about these thermoplastic polymers is, when we heat them, right, they will be softened, and on cooling they will become hard again. When you heat them, they will become soft, and cooling they will become what? Hard. So this property makes it easy for the reprocessing or recycling of these materials. And their intermolecular force are what? In between that of the elastomers and then fibers. The examples, right, polythene, polystyrene, polyvinyls, all these are what? Examples of the thermoplastic. So polyvinyls, you know, we can have polyvinyl chloride. Okay, so vinyl chloride, when we make an addition polymer, right, we will get what? PVC. In short, we call it as what? PVC. Okay, so this is what? The thermoplastic polymers. Again, I am repeating, whatever the examples we are seeing, you should always keep in mind that there can be a possible question on the examples. Next, we will go to a totally different type of polymer, which we call as the thermosetting polymer. The examples are also important. They'll have a very peculiar behavior. The examples are Bakelite and then urea formaldehyde resins. All these things we will discuss the actual structure. I mean, here we are just looking at the Bakelite structure, but we will study in detail about it when we go into the further discussion. The thing about these thermosetting polymers is, these are cross-linked or heavily branched molecules. Okay, so we'll have a cross-linking. Already we discussed about this cross-linking, right? They'll have cross-linking, or they'll have what? Heavily branched. But what is the peculiarity about these polymers is, on heating they will undergo excessive cross-linking, means, you know, we'll have more cross-linking being formed. As a result, they will be forming mold, and it cannot be reversed. They will then become what? Infusible. Fusion means what? When you heat it, something will basically turn into molten state. That is what you call as what? Fusion, right? They will become infusible, and that is a property which we exploit, like these, you know, electric switchboards and all that, right? They are made up of what? Thermosetting polymers. They become very, very hard on heating, and it is not reversible. You cannot reuse them. So once you make them hardened, right, that cannot be reprocessed. The examples for this are what? Bakelite and urea formaldehyde resins. Okay, so these must have what? These must be having, one, they must have cross linking and heavy branching, and the other thing is, once we heat them, they should form excessive cross linking. For the excessive cross linking, right, we must be having for the excessive cross linking to happen, right, when you heat it, it must form cross linking. We are saying there must be what? unsatisfied functional groups. Only then the further cross-linking can happen, right? So that is the thing that we need to keep in mind about the thermosetting polymers. Then, you know, we can also classify the polymers based on the growth polymerization. So how the polymers will actually be formed. Okay, so here, you know, we are talking particularly about what? The polymer synthesis. The addition polymers, right? So nowadays we also call them as what? Chain growth polymers. Based on how they will be synthesized, we can also call them as what? Chain growth polymers. We'll see the mechanism and all that later. Condensation polymers, we can call them as what? Step growth polymers. Okay, so based on the polymerization mechanism, right? How the polymerization mechanism happens step by step, we can also classify the polymers. Chain growth. Chain growth means what? Addition polymers. Step growth means what? Condensation. Okay, so we'll study about the mechanism in detail. Look at this question. What are polymers? What are polymers? These are what? Macromolecules with repeating units. That is how we can, in one word or in one line, describe the polymers best. Okay. And we can even give examples. Okay. How are polymers classified based on the structure? How they are classified? Long chain polymers. Chain branch. Third category is what? Cross-linked or network polymers. And we have seen the examples also for each of them. Okay, so whenever you see a classification of the polymers, all the different, we have classified the polymers based on different criteria, right? For each of these classification and the criteria that is used, we must remember the examples, because that is a very, very prominent question. If you see the past years, means you will understand what I am talking about. Okay. So this is about the classification of the polymers. Now what we will do is we will look at the mechanism. Addition polymerization mechanism. That is what we will be calling as what? The chain growth polymerization. Okay. So the molecules of the same monomer are different monomers. In case of homopolymer, only one monomer unit. In case of copolymer, we will have what? Two or more. They will be added together on a large scale to form the polymer. And the thing is what? The monomers must have unsaturation. Whether you have a double bond or diens or, you know, even triple bond. All these are what? You can have a single double bond or alkadienes, two double bonds, or we can have a triple bond also. Okay. Now the mode of polymerization, right, in case of the chain growth, the reason why the word chain growth itself is coming, right, is because the mode of polymerization will be leading to an increase in the chain length, or the chain will actually will grow. Okay, and this will happen either through the free radical mechanism or ionic mechanism, but here, you know, because this is the most common one, the free radical mechanism, which happens in the presence of the peroxides, right? That is the most common one. So we'll look at the free radical mechanism of the chain growth polymerization. So if you talk about the formation of, again, the same thing, so polyethene, we can use the peroxides like benzoyl peroxide or acetyl peroxide or tertiary butyl peroxide. They'll be what? The free radical generating initiator. So the free radical generating initiator, right? What are these? These are the peroxides. So that is the reason why we are saying these polymerization will be performed in what? In the presence of the peroxides. So we'll see what happens step by step. So first, you know, the benzoyl peroxide, in the presence of the heating or the sunlight, it will dissociate. Homolytic cleavage. That is when we'll get what? Radicals. Okay, so you see here, this is where it is undergoing the cleavage. We'll get two units of C6H5, COO. Then the CO2 will be lost. We'll get what? Phenyl radical. The phenyl radical will be going and adding on to the ethene. You see here, when it is adding on to the ethene, right, you add it here, you will form a radical which is now having a larger size, or, you know, we can say larger chain. This radical, when it is again going and attacking another ethene, you see what happens? These two will form a bond. Then we will get what? a radical which is even longer in terms of chain. So this way the chain growth will happen. So when a radical is going and attacking or adding, when a radical is adding onto the ethene, right, that is leading to what? Formation of a new radical which is longer in terms of chain. And this is what we will be calling as the chain propagating step. So first, the initiation is what? Formation of the phenyl radical from the benzyl peroxide. And the phenyl radical going and adding on to the ethene. That is the chain initiation. Then once this radical is formed, this can attack another ethene. And that continues. Step by step when it is adding, right? That's why we call it as what? Chain growth polymerization. You see here what is happening? The heating or exposing to the light will basically what? Do the homolytic cleavage of the benzyl peroxide. It will give us what? Phenyl radical. The phenyl radical will add onto the ethene double bond. And as a result, what we are getting? So when the phenyl radical is adding onto the ethene double bond, we are getting what? A larger free radical. Okay. So this step is what we will be calling as what? Chain initiating step. You see here the larger radical is come first when the phenyl is going and adding onto the ethene. This is the chain initiation, first part. Then the radical that is formed, right, from the chain initiation, this can be adding onto the another ethene molecule. As this progresses, right, we will get what? Bigger and bigger radicals will keep coming. So this step is what we will be referring as what? Chain propagating step. Ultimately what happens, as we have seen in case of free radical substitution of chlorine for the alkanes, right, there also we'll have what? Chain termination step. What is chain termination step? When two radicals combine. So when the radicals are combining with each other, right, they will be leading to what? Chain termination. So we'll see what happens in the chain termination. Look at this. If you have two radicals, they are combining, so they'll form a bond here. That's it. That is what? Chain termination. So this way we will be able to have what? The chain initiation, then chain propagation, then chain termination. So this is the chain growth polymerization, nothing but what? Addition polymerization. And you know, so here we have seen the example of what? The example of achieving the addition polymerization by using the free radical mechanism. Now particularly talking about the examples of these addition polymers, right? Polythene. We already said there are two types of these polythene. I mean, there are many types also, but in our coverage rate, we have what? Two types. LDP, low density polythene, and HDP. How is LDP obtained? It is obtained by the polymerization of ethene under high pressure. Look at it. Abnormally high pressure. 1000 to 2000 atmospheres. Think of it. Okay, normal pressure is what? 1 atm. 1000 to 2000 times more than that. And temperature is what? 350 to 570. So the catalyst is what? Again, dioxin or peroxide. The low density polythene, right? So we'll see actually what is the low density polythene. We'll have what? As we already said, we'll have a long chain and there will be the branches. So how we'll be able to obtain these branches is the important thing, because already as the mechanism, previous mechanism we saw, right, what we are able to obtain, only we are able to obtain the long chain. How the branching occurs is, if for one of the carbons of the long chain, we remove the hydrogen, that is what we call as hydrogen abstraction. From one of the carbons of the long chain, we remove a hydrogen. That will form what? A valency deficit carbon. That will be forming a valency deficit carbon. So now, as a branch, a ethene can be added over there. So you see here, the branch will continue. So to the long chain that is there, we will do what? Hydrogen abstraction. Means we are removing hydrogen. There the valency deficit comes. To that carbon, the branching can begin. So one thing that we need to keep in mind is, it is the same monomer unit that is repeating both in the main long chain as well as the branching. So the LDP, right, is obtained by the free radical addition along with the hydrogen atom abstraction. Means what? Removing the hydrogen atom. That is what will give the valency deficit in the main chain, and that will lead to the formation of the branches. The LDP, right? Remember, guys, you know, we also said this LDP can be also called as what? LDPE, low density polyethylene. So the low density polyethylene, because of the branching rate, the packaging will be inefficient. That's why it is having what? Low density. It will be one chemically inert and tough, but it will be flexible. And because it is flexible, right, we will be using it in squeeze bottles. I'm sure, you know, when you go to a restaurant and all that, you'll see these squeeze bottles, right? They are basically made up of what? LDP, toys, flexible pipes. All of them are made up of what? LDP. And the LDP is also what? It's a poor conductor of the electricity. So this is about the low density polyethylene. The next type of polyethylene is the HDP, high density polyethylene. So high density polyethylene, the mechanism of the synthesis will be little different. So the polymerization of ethene, right, will take place in the hydrocarbon solvent with a catalyst. The catalyst, know that we will be referring to here is the catalyst that will belong to a class of catalyst called as Ziegler-Natta catalyst. So the one that we'll mostly talk about is the triethyl aluminium with titanium tetrachloride. So we also have other class of catalyst which we will be referring as the Ziegler-Natta catalyst. We'll talk about that. So the two scientists, right, the Ziegler-Natta catalyst is credited for the Natta from Imperia town in Italy, and Ziegler, Carl Ziegler, from the Germany. So with this catalyst, right, the reaction polymerization can happen at a moderate temperature itself, 333 to 343. And look at the pressure also, no? The LDP, we were requiring 1000 to 2000 atmosphere pressure. But here, what is the pressure requirement? Just 6 to 7 atmosphere. So the high density polyethylene that is prepared, right, will just have what? Long chain. And hence, there will be more efficient packing. So that is the reason why it will have high density. And also, it will be chemically inert as well as a tougher and harder. So because it is having the hardness, right, it is used for the manufacture of buckets, dustbins, you can see here, bottles, pipes. So all these are made up of what? HDP or HDPE, high density polyethylene. We'll just take a look at the mechanism. So Ziegler-Natta catalyst, right, they are a group of catalyst. Typically, what are those? Transition metal halides with an organometallic reagent. Like, you know, we can have alkyl aluminium, lithium, zinc, magnesium. So you see here, titanium tetrachloride with what? Organometallic reagent. So mostly we can talk about the triethyl aluminium. So what happens is, when the two undergo the reaction, there will be a exchange. The R group will be bond to the titanium, and the chlorine, one of the chlorines from the TaCl4, will be bonding to the respective metal, whether it is magnesium or lithium or aluminium, whichever it is. So this active form of the Ziegler-Natta catalyst, right, this will start binding to the monomer unit. You see here, if you take the monomer unit as generally, you know, we can talk about CH2 double bond CHR. If R is hydrogen, means what? That is ethene. If R is CH3, means what? That is propene, like that. Okay, so we have the activated catalyst combining with what? The monomer unit. You see here, what is it? There is an interaction between the pi electron cloud and the titanium, because titanium will have what? Vacant orbitals. And this interaction will be rearranging itself into what you see here. That will rearrange itself into the entire monomer unit will be bonded to the titanium as well as the R dash group. The R dash group is basically the group that is coming from the organometallic entity. This will now have the titanium, which is having a vacant orbital available. So this will be interacting with another monomer unit. The interaction is between titanium, vacant orbital, and the pi electron cloud. Again, there will be rearrangement. You see here, the chain length is increasing. So this way, as it is repeating many number of times, right, the chain length keeps on increasing, and that is what will be giving rise to the polymer chain. Similarly, we can also have, along with the titanium, right, we can also have The Ziegler Natta catalyst made from the vanadium, zirconium, even chromium also. So if you have a zirconium complex, right, that can interact, same method, interact with the pi electron cloud of the ethene. That will come into the complex. So again, you know, this will further interact with the zirconium, will further interact with another monomer unit. The zirconium vacant orbitals will interact with what, the pi electron cloud. Again, it will undergo rearrangement. So you see here, the chain length keeps on increasing. So we can have, most prominently, we'll talk about what, titanium tetrachloride, and then triethyl aluminium. So this is the combination of Ziegler-Natta catalyst that we'll be referring to mostly. Okay, but we can also have other class of the Ziegler-Natta catalyst. The idea is what, the interaction between the transition metal, vacant orbitals, and the pi electron cloud, that is what will be resulting in the form of the formation of these addition polymer. The other example is the Teflon poly tetrafluoroethene. So what is this poly tetrafluoroethene? So we have tetrafluoroethene as the monomer. This will undergo polymerization. So this will undergo polymerization with a free radical mechanism. We can either use persulfate. So persulfate is basically, remember, we'll talk about it in the sulfuric acid chapter, P block, H2S2O8. So it will have what, S2O8 2 minus entity, the persulfate entity. Okay, so that can be used as a catalyst with high pressure, the addition polymerization. We'll get what, Teflon. So CF2 bond CF2, that is the repeating unit. This one, right, will have very characteristic property of non-stick surface, and that is what is going to make it used in the cooking utensils, right, the coating, non-stick pan and all that, you will see, right, this type of things will come, dishes and all that, they will mark it by saying non-stick. So that is basically what, Teflon. So these specific applications, right, we need to remember. So it is used in the making of the oil seals, gaskets, as well as the most important one is what, the non-stick surface of the utensils, that is what is Teflon. And the Teflon, right, will be undergoing the decomposition at a temperature which is above 300 degrees Celsius. So above this temperature, the Teflon will be undergoing what, decomposition. Then the another important addition polymer is polyacrylonitrile. So this is in short also called as what, PAN, PAN. Acrylonitrile, what is it? CH2 double bond CHCN. This is what, acrylonitrile. This will undergo polymerization, same addition polymerization, peroxide as a catalyst. So you see here, what is the structures are also important. Polyacrylonitrile, what is it? CH2 CHCN, that will be the repeating unit. Polyacrylonitrile, right, it is used as a substituent of wool. So these are the kind of wordings that we have to focus on. So they will say a polymer used as a substituent for wool. What is it? It is the PAN, polyacrylonitrile. They will ask, what is the monomer for that? What is the structure of monomer for that? Okay. And this polyacrylonitrile is used in making of these commercial fibers, Orlon and Acrylon. These are what the commercial names for the fibers made from the polyacrylonitrile. These names also we need to keep in mind. Okay, so these acrylic fibers, right, they have good resistance to stain and chemicals as well as insects and fungi. So that will find specific applications, because they are resistance to stain as well as chemicals, right, they can be used for, you know, making these materials that are used in, you know, chemical industry or chemical laboratory, etc. Okay, so this is about the polyacrylonitrile, but the most important thing is what, substituent for wool. This is the word that we need to remember. We'll talk about condensation polymerization. So in fact, what we'll be referring to it as, we'll refer to it as step growth polymerization. Addition is what, chain growth. Condensation is what, step growth polymerization. And then we'll also talk about the other polymer examples. We talked about Bakelite, we talked about, you know, the other the synthetic rubbers, natural rubber, all these things we'll see in the second part video. Okay, all the best, and keep watching more videos from our channel.